Life and Earth are two closely intertwined realities that have mutually influenced each other for billions of years. But how can we describe this connection? How can we explain the role of life in Earth's history and vice versa? These questions have captivated and challenged scientists from various disciplines who have sought to formulate hypotheses to interpret the available data and evidence. In the 70s, the idea emerged that planet Earth could actually be a colossal superorganism, with all animals, plants, fungi, and other forms of life actively influencing each other's evolution. This concept became known as the Gaia Hypothesis. It seemed beautiful and comforting, especially in the dark days of the Cold War, to think of Earth as an enormous and conscious entity aware of its purpose. The idea gained popularity and inspired generations of environmentalists. The only problem was that many scientists felt there was a lack of scientific evidence. Some even proposed the exact opposite idea, suggesting that Mother Earth doesn't have a particularly bright future for us and might be contemplating how to eliminate complex life forms, returning to the simplicity of a unicellular environment. This is the Medea Hypothesis, an opposing and contrasting view that offers a different way of conceiving the relationship between life and Earth. So, in this captivating, melancholic video, we'll explore the origins, characteristics, and implications of these two theories. In the finale, we'll conclude with an analysis of how these hypotheses have been received in the scientific community, and discuss the future prospects for research in this field. What do you say? Shall we proceed? The Gaia Hypothesis, which we've already discussed on Insane Curiosity, was first formulated by the English scientist James Lovelock in 1979. It is a theory that suggests multicellular life on Earth should be conceived as a superorganism that maintains and regulates the habitability conditions of the planet, striving to preserve itself from any degeneration. According to Lovelock, throughout its history, multicellular life on Earth has created or contributed to creating various conditions favorable to its existence. This includes the production or consumption of atmospheric gases, the modification of the carbon cycle, the generation of beneficial substances, and more. These conditions have led to equilibrium situations that ensured the survival of complex life and hindered a return to microbiotic life. In this sense, multicellular life is seen as a creative force that modifies and adapts the environment to its own needs. James Lovelock, a chemist and environmentalist who passed away last summer at the impressive age of 103, was invited to work on the Viking missions in the 1970s to assess whether the analysis of the Martian atmosphere could provide clues about the possible presence of life. Lovelock suggested that if the Viking landers had found a significant amount of oxygen in the Martian atmosphere, it would be indicative of microbial activity. However, as we now know, the atmosphere of Mars, like Venus, is composed of 96% carbon dioxide, which, according to Lovelock, would rule out any possibility in that regard. The question arose, why did carbon dioxide prevail on Mars while not on Earth? The hypothesis emerged that Earth has natural negative feedback systems that manage to keep both the percentage of oxygen and especially carbon dioxide levels low. Plants and microbes perform photosynthesis, absorbing carbon dioxide and producing oxygen, while animals absorb oxygen and produce carbon dioxide. It seemed that life itself maintained the right balance between these two gases on Earth. The Gaia Hypothesis was met with interest and curiosity by some scientists, but also with skepticism and hostility from others who viewed it as a form of vitalism or mysticism, incompatible with the scientific method and the principles of evolutionary biology. Among the most frequent criticisms were accusations that Lovelock attributed purpose or intentionality to life, which couldn't be proven or measured, contradicting the concept of natural selection based on randomness and competition. Additionally, there were doubts about the validity of the evidence and examples provided by Lovelock to support his hypothesis, often based on simplified mathematical models or suggestive analogies rather than rigorous ones. Lovelock, however, didn't give up and continued to develop and defend his hypothesis, seeking to make it more scientific and acceptable. He collaborated with other scientists, including microbiologist Lynn Margulis, who reinforced the hypothesis by providing concrete and documented examples of how microorganisms could modify the environment and how these changes were advantageous for life. Margulis later distanced herself from Lovelock, considering him too influenced by vitalism, and proposed a more moderate and less anthropocentric version of the hypothesis, where life is not attributed purpose or intentionality, but only an adaptive capacity. Despite its difficulties and controversies, the Gaia hypothesis stimulated reflection and research on the relationship between life and Earth. It raised awareness about ecological and sustainability issues, and proposed an ethical vision that taught everyone to respect and protect life as a value in itself, not just as a means to other ends. Even in the absence of clear scientific evidence, the Gaia hypothesis has proven to be a favorable argument for all the environmental battles fought later. Before moving on, don't forget to subscribe to our channel if you haven't already. Make sure to hit the notification bell so you don't miss out on our daily videos. In 2009, however, came a big surprise. While everyone was still trying to refine Gaia and take advantage of the otherwise unproven theory's rather new age drift, Peter Douglas Ward emerged seemingly out of nowhere. Ward, a paleontologist and professor at the University of Washington in the departments of geology, biology, and astronomy, published a book that year presenting ideas almost entirely contrary to those supported by Gaia. Ward was an expert in mass extinctions, particularly studying the Permian extinction, the largest and most devastating in Earth's history, causing the disappearance of over 90% of living species. This extinction event, colloquially called the Great Dying, seems to have been caused by an imbalance of excess carbon dioxide in the atmosphere. There were other mass extinction events, such as the methane poisoning 3.5 billion years ago, the 2.45 billion year old oxygen catastrophe, the two phases known as Snowball Earth, and five distinct anoxic events caused by increased hydrogen sulfide. Ward saw these mass extinction episodes as evidence that the entire Earth's ecosystem went out of balance. He hypothesized that in a more or less distant future, the atmosphere would lose all its carbon dioxide once tectonic and volcanic activity on Earth ceased. Consequently, less and less carbon dioxide would be released into the atmosphere, condemning the planet to the inevitable extinction of all photosynthetic life forms. Ward then questioned how life could cause such a catastrophic event, repeating itself several times through its evolution. His answer was that life was not just a collection of isolated organisms, but an integrated and complex system, acting as a single living organism capable of altering the planet's environmental conditions. The book was titled The Medea Hypothesis. Is life on Earth ultimately self-destructive? And Ward coined the term Medea Hypothesis, in opposition to Gaia, to describe the ways in which complex life ultimately does not bring balance and love to Earth, but continues to attempt its own extinction. The name refers to the mythical Medea, the sorceress who kills her own children to avenge her husband Jason, who had abandoned her. In this case, Medea represents Earth, and her children represent multicellular life that evolved about 1.5 billion years ago. According to the Medea hypothesis, multicellular life is a temporary and anomalous deviation from Earth's normal state, which is dominated by microorganisms such as bacteria and archaea. These simple life forms are much harder, resistant, and adaptable than complex life, and can survive in extreme conditions such as high temperatures, pressures, salinities, acidity, etc. Multicellular life, on the other hand, is much more fragile, dependent, and vulnerable, requiring stable and favorable environmental conditions, such as a certain amount of light, heat, water, oxygen, etc. In support of his claims, Ward argues that multicellular life throughout its history has caused or contributed to various mass extinctions, drastically reducing Earth's biodiversity and biomass. These extinctions have been triggered by environmental changes induced by biological activities, such as the production or consumption of atmospheric gases, modification of the carbon cycle, generation of toxic substances, etc. These changes have led to situations of imbalance, stress, or crises, endangering the survival of complex life and favoring the return to elementary life forms. In this sense, according to Ward, multicellular life would be a negative and destructive force that undermines the habitability conditions of the planet, continually tending to eliminate itself. According to Ward's thinking, the superorganism encompassing every form of organic and inorganic existence would be more akin to the myth of Medea than of Gaia. Instead of a benevolent goddess, we would be in the hands of a stepmother nature that, like the eponymous protagonist of the Greek tragedy, kills her own children. The idea was met with interest and curiosity by some scientists, but also with skepticism and hostility from others who considered it a form of catastrophism or pessimism, incompatible with the scientific method and the principles of evolutionary biology. Among the most frequent criticisms were those accusing Ward of attributing purpose or intentionality to life, which could not be demonstrated or measured, and contradicted the concept of natural selection based on randomness and cooperation. Additionally, some questioned the validity of the evidence and examples provided by Ward to support his hypothesis, often based on debatable interpretations or forced analogies, but lacking rigor. Ward, however, did not give up and continued to develop and defend his hypothesis, aiming to make it more scientific and acceptable. To achieve this, he collaborated with other scientists, including geologist David Grinspoon, who had studied planetary evolution and habitability conditions. Grinspoon contributed to strengthening the Medea hypothesis by providing concrete and documented examples of how microorganisms could alter the environment and how these changes were detrimental to life. For instance, Grinspoon demonstrated how sulfur-reducing prokaryotes were responsible for the production of hydrogen sulfide, a toxic gas that had caused various mass extinctions, including the Permian extinction. Moreover, Grinspoon distanced himself from Ward, considering him too influenced by catastrophism, and proposed a more moderate and less anthropocentric version of the Medea hypothesis, attributing to life not a purpose or intentionality, but only a capacity to interact with its constituent elements. The theory is challenging, controversial, and ambitious. On one hand, it strives to encompass diverse disciplines, and on the other, it seeks factual evidence in epochs so remote that everything, despite the immortal evidence offered by rocks, becomes entangled in the territory of doubt. However, it remains a hypothesis, precisely. How should we interpret the fact that these suicide attempts remain just that, never reaching the fateful 100%, thereby declaring a return to a terrestrial life dominated by microbes? Is it a flaw in the theory? Perhaps. Or the intervention of a counteracting force? In Ward's hypothesis, there is no trace of this objection, and from the lack of answers emerges a paradox. Life propagates precisely because it harbors suicidal tendencies, yet through its repeated attempts at self-annihilation, it inadvertently promotes biodiversity. In summary, according to Ward, the number of animal and plant species peaked in the Cambrian half a billion years ago and has since continued to decrease along with the percentage of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere. This is despite the current upward trend caused by human use of fossil fuels. Ward expects this trend to lead to the disappearance of most plant life, followed by the oxygen deficiency of animals, long before changes in the sun condemn life on Earth forever. In other words, life processes themselves will eventually destroy life. Ward is also pessimistic about our chances of terraforming and colonizing other worlds in this or other solar systems. The best hope for our species is to minimize its impact on the planet and adopt a low profile integrated with our intelligence. We must change the natural world benevolently and deliberately. Only engineering will save us now, he concludes. It's time to roll up our sleeves, pull out the slide rules, encourage the experts, and get to work. All of us.